Are your dreams as big as your God?
Yes.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Amen.
Amen.
God like faith.
Amen.
What God is speaking unto us today about dreams is not necessarily limited to those nighttime, you know, events that happen while you're sleeping. Amen.
Amen.
It's not limited to those. Even though we know God does speak through dreams, we see it in the Bible, right? In a dream, he spoke to Joseph many times, telling him to take the child into Egypt, amen, the child and his mother to Egypt. And then another time, take the child and his mother and go back, amen. And God speaks in dreams, so we understand that. But I think we want to understand this a little bit better by thinking about vision, amen. Because God gives us vision. Amen. He speaks vision into our hearts. And an unfulfilled vision is always the source of dissatisfaction.
Jesus.
Right? Because if God speaks a vision to you, until your outer reality matches the inner vision, you're going to be dissatisfied. But you'll know this ain't it. Amen. When I'm going and I'm looking for a job, or I'm looking for a home, or I'm looking to transact some business, I get there and the folk on the job look in ways and there's fields and ways. This is not it.
Mm-hmm.
This is not what I want. Envisioned.
Mm-hmm.
Right? God spoke something else to me. Amen. This is not it. You know, this is not the house for me. Amen.
Mm-hmm.
No, this is not it. Why? Because God spoke a vision. He gave you something. And God gives his people vision.
Amen.
You have to have a vision. Amen. Because when God talks about vision, it's talking about, amen, really is talking about prophetic revelation. He reveals things to you that he intends to bring to pass in your life. It says this. He said, where there's no vision, what happened? People perish. It says, without a vision, the people perish. They cast off restraint. You know what that means? They start doing any old thing. No restraint. They do this, they do that. They do that, they do the other. There's no restraint to them, amen?
Mm-hmm.
They just do stuff. They do things that lead to their demise. But how many of you know when you have a vision, you have a restraint, but it's a good restraint. You know why? Because now you are restrained from doing other things that are incompatible with the vision. Right?
Right.
It makes you more focused. When God gives you a vision and says, listen, and, you know, you grow up in a certain neighborhood, it's a depressed neighborhood, it's filled with crime and drug dealing, and God gives you a vision that he's going to take you out of this place. He's going to take you to institutions of higher education that are away from here. He's going to place you in jobs, and he's going to put you before great men. If you catch that vision and believe that vision, it now makes you focus. And so even though the peer pressure is there to start running the streets and slinging drugs, you say, "Now I'm not doing that." Well, you think you're better than someone? Now, I'm not saying I'm better, but I got a vision. And see, so it makes you focus. It makes you restrained. But see, when you have no vision, you cast off restraint. You start doing anything. Yo, man, let's go over here. All right. Let's go over here. All right. Next thing you know, you're doing the jailhouse shuffle, right? Because you got caught. Because you were not restrained. But a guy who has vision, a woman who has vision, they go, "I'm not doing that."
Amen.
Amen.
That's right.
God gave me that. I got something in my heart.
He
got the guy come, "Well, you know, if you really love me, you know, you would." The devil is a liar, amen. I got vision. My vision is not pushing around no nappy head kid of yours in a stroller at 15, 16 years. No. I got what? A vision. And so know what it helps you do? To be restrained. When God gives us vision, and vision has to come from God. I'm not talking about stuff you thought of. God gave me a vision, and I'm going to come over there, take over your house, and take your wife.
Oh, Lord Jesus.
See? No, he didn't tell you that. Amen? That ain't obedient. That ain't obedient to the word. Amen?
Amen.
The devil's a liar, and so are you. Amen? Get out of here.
That's right.
So So we get the vision. We want to get a vision. Why? Because it's a prophetic revelation that comes from God. And God says in Jeremiah, he said, I know the thoughts I have for you. You know what another translation says? I know the plans I have for you. Mm-hmm. Amen. God has a plan for you.
Amen.
See, that should make you happy right there.
Yes.
God has a plan for me.
Amen.
You might not have a plan right now, but you say, I don't know what I'm going to do. That's okay, but God has a plan for you.
Amen.
Amen. And the thing you really want to know is God's plan anyway.
Amen.
And I tell you, sometimes it takes you to get to the end of your plan before you can hear God's plan. Where I am right now, it's not ending like this. Why? Because God has a plan, don't you know? God is up to something.
Amen.
He has me on his mind. Because don't you know you have to hold on to the vision God gives you? Because the devil's trying to wrestle it out of your hand and out of your heart. He's trying to get you to start thinking about your present circumstance. But every time you got to look at your present circumstance and say, it's not ending here. God has something else for me that is greater than this.
Hallelujah.
But are your dreams as big as your God? Because we got to make sure that what we're dreaming and believing on is bigger than ourselves. If you can readily see yourself doing the thing that God has spoken unto you, God didn't speak it. See, because it's got to be too big. And the other thing is this too. You know it's not you when you ain't running after it, you're waiting on it.
Jesus.
Right? Because you don't feel you got to roll up your sleeves and try to get it done. You just waiting for instruction from God. Mm-hmm. Amen? Somebody asks you, how long are you going to believe God? It's a one-word answer. Until.
Amen.
God is your abundant compensation. Your reward shall be exceedingly great. I love God. He just can't stop at great.
No.
Exceedingly great. God does what? Exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think. We got to be careful that just because something is taking a long time, don't start to water down God's promise. If God promised you something, don't start going, well, I can just make it okay with this. If that's not what God promised you, don't do that.
Amen.
Amen?
Amen?
Don't substitute anything for God has promised you. If God promised you something, you wait on it until that something comes.
Amen.
Not something else. Amen?
Amen?
You got a vision that God gave you, a godly husband. Or something. Don't take that choker and say, well, ain't God going to change him.
Amen. That's right.
If God said he's going to give you a godly husband, he needs to be godly when he say, I do.
Amen.
Come on, somebody. He ain't never going to give you a husband and make him godly.
No.
That's a different promise. Don't water down God's promise. Don't say something is good enough if God is speaking higher. Are your dreams as big as your God? And see, that's what happens. God will speak something to us. We'll get it for a while, but the passage of time will make us diminish the size of the promise.
Mm-hmm.
Before, we were believing this big, but now we're here.
Mm-hmm.
And we try to do it as if we're being, you know, spiritual. You're believing. But now your God is sovereign. God's always been sovereign.
Amen.
It's not a question of God's sovereignty. Don't try to use your lack of faith and hide it behind God being sovereign. If God spoke this big, don't say, well, he wants to do what he said.
Amen.
The question is, can you still believe him for what he said, or has the passage of time caused you to diminish the promise in your eyes? Are your dreams as big as your God? When God spoke it, you got to keep it on the same scale he spoke it. That's what God promised me.